Our speaker today will be introduced by Logan Ramirez, class of 2001. Logan is a voice analyst at Secure Logics and a director on the San Antonio Alumni Chapter Board. Logan.
Well, hello everybody, and again, welcome. It is my, it's my honor, it really is, to introduce you. We do an alumni event, and every year we do lots of alumni events, one of which is supporting local theater, and I get to connect from time to time with that department through that event. Stacey Connelly received her Ph.D. in theater at Indiana University in Bloomington, and then went to Germany as a fellow of German Academic Exchange Service. For 5 years, she was a visiting professor at Loyola University, Chicago. She is currently an associate professor at Trinity here in San Antonio, where she teaches text analysis, performance, and dramaturgy, which I had to look up and I will not attempt to explain. She also directs productions for Trinity's theater program and is a director and dramaturg for Attic Rep, Trinity's resident professional theater company. Her articles on German theater and political drama have appeared in regional and national journals. This summer, she will be directing George Bernard Shaw's comedy, Arms and the Man, as the opening production of the Classic Theater Company's 2014-15 season. It's my privilege to introduce and welcome up here Dr. Stacey Connelly.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Logan, and thanks to Salim Sharif and Alumni Relations for this chance to talk about two of my passions, theater and theatrical criticism in San Antonio. So, why then are we looking at a picture of a guy in a powdered wig? Allow me to introduce you to Gotthold Lessing, a German poet, playwright, philosopher, essayist, and theorist who was invited in 1767, the year that this portrait was made, by a group of businessmen to serve as the resident dramaturg of the new Hamburg National Theater. So what in the heck is a dramaturg? I'm a dramaturg. Dramaturgs practice dramaturgy. Does that clear it up? Right. It's a very elastic term that encompasses the following, because it depends on the theater's needs. As literary managers, dramaturgs help craft a theater's mission and guide the season selection process. Dramaturgs read and evaluate many plays submitted to the theaters each year and then develop a select few into new productions. They and their dramaturgical staff research the plays they produce, the historical context, setting, characters, themes, and thus they educate. They educate the directors, actors, designers, and audience with presentations, information packets, lobby displays, and program notes. Finally, they serve the theater as in-house critics, watching rehearsals, offering criticism, and advocating for playwrights and their work. These were the many duties that Gotthold Lessing invented and undertook as the very first dramaturg, a job that transformed him into the model and patron saint of dramaturgs the world over. He's kind of my heartthrob, actually. So, Lessing's collection of 100 essays, Hamburg Dramaturgy, was a watershed in theatrical criticism, for its ambition was nothing less than the remaking of European theater. Lessing analyzed and reviewed his theater's plays and playwrights, evaluated the play's actors, directors, and designers, condemned the appalling taste of most theaters and their audiences, including the theater that paid his salary, and insisted that German theater stop aping French models and create a national drama of its own. Thus, in only 3 years, Lessing established a critical foundation for German theater that moved Germany to the forefront of the dramatic arts and created the finest and most popular plays of the 19th century. His guidance of a single influential theater, along with his rigorous standards of writing and production, positioned his host city, Hamburg, as a leader in arts and literature and in the shaping of German national identity. Identity. So what is our city's identity? And how do our cultural activities define San Antonio? Well, a comparison might help us here. To answer that question, let's visit one of our neighbors. Driving around in Austin, Texas, you often see bumper stickers that read, "Keep Austin Weird." Yeah, yeah, you've seen it, haven't you? An affectionately subversive slogan designed to promote the arts and Austin's small hometown businesses. It's also a reaction to the capital city's explosive emergence in the last decade from its alternative music, hippie cowboy, college town culture, into a higher octane capital of science, technology, and as we say in Texas, big business, right? And as you can see, this slogan, it's everywhere. Clearly, many Austinites believe that preserving Austin's artiness, quirkiness, and cherished role as Texas's countercultural capital is vital to its success and unique identity. Not to be outdone, I just love this picture. It's so Keep Austin Weird. Not to be outdone, Austin's nearest neighbor, San Antonio, launched a similar underground campaign in 2005 for the Alamo City, immortalized in bumper stickers that entreat its citizens to keep San Antonio. Yes, ding, ding, ding. Yes, with the A, notice the A in lame drawn in the shape of the Alamo, of course. This less than ringing endorsement not only invited immediate and unflattering comparison between San Antonio and its more upscale neighbor to the north, Weird is, after all, so much hipper sounding than lame, but also provoked baffled reactions about the intentions of San Antonio's campaign and even the very nature of its counterculture. A citywide conversation arose contemplating the elusive qualities encompassed in lame and whether indeed lameness was a trait to be celebrated and preserved at all. This is actually from the Keep San Antonio Lame website. I thought I'd show you that. Predictably, the sentiment not only drew outrage among many of our citizens, but it also inspired guffaws of recognition. For the San Antonio defenders, lame was totally unwarranted, and they let the founders of the Keep San Antonio Lame movement hear about it. Didn't San Antonio have the Spurs, the Riverwalk, the Alamo, museums, the McNay, a symphony, a ballet, an opera, lots of theater? Two magnet schools for the performing arts. In response to this indignant backlash, Aaron Forland, the founder of the Keep San Antonio Lame movement, was interviewed on Texas Matters, a locally produced news magazine broadcast through our local NPR affiliate, KSTX, or Texas Public Radio. Forland assured listeners that lame was in fact a compliment. Some people, he said, have a problem with irony. He explained, without irony, I'm pretty certain, that it's a constant thing that you hear, especially amongst young people, that it's lame here, that there's not much to do. But there is a lot to do, and I'm of the opinion that if the city is lame, let's keep it that way. It's a wonderful lameness. You don't have to go to Austin, you don't have to go to New York to find interesting contemporary things going on. Well, as much as I love San Antonio, and I do, I see the cloud in Forland's every silver lining. Davy Crockett and Tim Duncan notwithstanding, we have a symphony that filed for bankruptcy in 2003 and continues to struggle, a tiny opera company that went bankrupt in May of 2012, a ballet that let go of all but five of its company the year before and cut its season in half, and an arts magnet school that was threatened with closure in 2011 if it did not find corporate donors. Even though we are the seventh largest city in America, As for the theatrical landscape, it is well-intentioned, ranging from visiting national tours to funky Southtown performance art to community theater. Overall, though, it is a less than wonderful lameness. Few trained artists, a small audience, dismal funding, and very little interest from most media outlets. We have a few companies that pay actors, and only three companies that occasionally use actors' equity, the union guest artist contracts. We have 8 colleges or universities with active theater programs. We have less than a third of the producing organizations than our weird neighbor to the north. Many of us involved in theater education find San Antonio's minor league reputation frustrating. For us, keep San Antonio lame provoked laughter, of course. The phrase's embattled tone made it sound as if some volcano of sophistication was threatening to erupt at any minute. But it also produced unease, a suspicion that underneath the satire was not criticism, but complacency, even comfort in San Antonio's lame status. It was a sobering proposition that San Antonio's counterculture might actually be a counterculture. Exhibit A is San Antonio's preeminent theatrical event, specifically the Alamo Theater Arts Council, or ATAC, Globe Awards. Our lame version of the Tonys, I guess. In 2009, less than a week before this annual gala, the San Antonio Current, our city's alternative weekly and cultural organ, launched the first salvo of the San Antonio Counterculture Wars. The article was titled, "Another Gold Star: How to Make the Globes More Like the Tonys and Less Like School Attendance Awards." Penned by Thomas Jenkins, a local theater critic and associate professor of classical studies here at Trinity University, it was the most unheard of thing you've ever heard of. Someone daring, on the very eve of its award ceremony, to publicly discuss, nay, interrogate, nay, criticize ATAC, the mysterious cabal that judges and rewards theatrical excellence in San Antonio. It was a shocking expose, a brutal behind-the-scenes look at a clan of community theater personnel that regularly judges, praises, and awards globes to, according to Jenkins, apparently just about everyone. In fact, Mr. Jenkins claimed that giving out 34 Best Actress awards in 1 year, 18 for Best Actress and 16 for Best Supporting Actress, was probably excessive and actually diminished the value of the distinction. He went on to berate ATAC for its lack of discrimination, its praise of mediocrity, and its neglect of worthy productions. For example, Jenkins noted that in the previous year's awards, not only did mediocre productions win Globe Awards for excellence, but shows that actually were excellent somehow didn't. The Sellers production of Electricidad, a Chicano take on Greek tragedy by MacArthur genius Luis Alfaro, was top-notch with especially strong female acting and superb direction by Maricela Barrera. Its final award count? 0. Was it not possible for even one actress in Electricidad to join the ranks of her 34, again not a typo, sisters? In addition to ATAC's apparent philosophy of everybody's a winner in San Antonio, Jenkins decried the judges' Philistine tastes, scoffing at their puritanical rejection of content that was edgy, political, or too contemporary. Said Jenkins, "I call to witness this year's bizarre slate of award-winning productions and, just as importantly, a few of the surprisingly unnominated productions. Whereas the Sellers thoroughly under-rehearsed and infelicitously staged El Grande de Coca-Cola will snag an award for excellence at the October 18th gala, not just for pretty goodness, mind you, but excellence. The main stage's Altar Boys, which was smashing and slick and wonderful and funny, gets nothing, not even for Christopher Rodriguez's hilarious choreography. And while lightweight scripts like Don't Dress for Dinner and The Odd Couple are showered with globes, the Attic Rep's hard-hitting productions of Albee's The Goat and Harrower's Blackbird end up with bupkis. I'm beginning to believe that the Globe judges' generally conservative sensibilities tend to skew the results not towards excellence, but towards 1950. and that innovative artists and plays that grapple with arresting contemporary issues are therefore ignored. This is reprehensible. An award process that consistently ignores excellence is a farce. And no, ATAC should not award itself a Globe for comedy. Then the critic got personal, condemning ATAC's judges as biased and unqualified, saying that those judges, too heavily invested in the local theater scene, particularly directors and producers, should bow out of the process. We must interrogate judges about potential conflicts of interests, besides merely their spouses, and that includes coworkers, friends, furtive and drunken liaisons, etc. If this leaves too few judges, cancel the awards. Excellence is not to be compromised. Jenkins even went so far as to aver that judges should prove that they're qualified, submitting credentials and a sample review for examination. In a final coup de grace, the critic actually suggested that Texan exceptionalism notwithstanding, San Antonians should model their awards organization and policies on those of more established and similarly sized theatrical communities like St. Louis or Washington, D.C. Well, the staff of the Current braced itself for the counterattack. As they expected, the unflattering article struck a nerve. A blitzkrieg of postings appeared within a few hours, nearly all of them expressing surprise, relief, and even rapturous support of Jenkins's position. Most of the respondents thanked the critic for finally mentioning the elephant in the wings. Apparently, Jenkins had put center stage the discontent that San Antonio thespians had been grumbling about in green rooms for years. One unidentified reader spoke. "Finally, someone is speaking up about this. The judging of the ATAC Awards is so blatantly biased. Nearly all the judges are involved in the theater community and have major conflicts of interest. The same actors win for the same types of productions at the same theaters every year." Big caps right there. "Good shows get overlooked. The best excuse ATAC members' judges can come up with for this is that there are too many shows for every judge to see every year. Complete BS and everyone knows it. If you don't subscribe to their way of thinking, the ATAC people completely snub you or refuse to recognize you in any way. This is theatrical fascism. Let's get some real objective judges in the ATACs." Phew. And that was just the first posting. It was followed by many, many posts, the most responses the Current had ever received to an article, containing evidently long years of bottled rage, sarcasm, and righteous recriminations that burst forth to smite the unsuspecting board members of the Alamo Theater Arts Council, who seemed stunned at such a hostile response. Proponents of the ATAC Awards also contributed to the comments thread. An anonymous voice declared, "All art is subjective, period. If it were objective, it would be called math. Stop blaming the powers that be for expressing their opinions." Another writer answered the complaints with counter-criticism. "It is easy, it seems to me, to sit back and throw stones at others who are merely trying to celebrate the art that we all, even the complainers, love. Is the process fair and objective? Perhaps not. Like the healthcare debate, you must join in the process to fix the problem. How many of you sitting on the sidelines in high dudgeon are willing to go out and see 25 pieces of theater each year? Making the Globes more relevant is a work in progress. Sitting on the sidelines and whining about it accomplishes nothing." In reply came dozens of postings deriding ATAC's anonymous defender, with some people hinting darkly about conspiracy. Quote, "ATAC had a chance to correct its stupidity last year after it was brought to their attention. They did nothing. No one is sitting on the sidelines whining. It's just that the Bernie Madoff scheme of local theater excellence has been exposed. I assume you are one of the problems, and don't give us that crap about judges going out to see 25 pieces of theater each year. If they can't stand the heat, then get out of the kitchen and get the board of directors to cite conflict of interest when their productions are nominated. What a bunch of self-serving phonies," end quote. Together, both sides engaged in an outpouring of thoughts and emotions about the role of theater and theater awards in San Antonio. A debate ensued, descending at times to predictably appalling depths of pettiness and backbiting. Quote, this community is a bunch of backstabbing double talkers. You should all be ashamed of yourselves. An anonymous sniping about previous award winners, quote, Rick Sanchez is the least humble person in the theater community. He even posts reviews about himself on the social networking sites. Some readers made fun of the awards with their own rival versions. A longtime critic of the established theaters in town, John Poole, then co-director of the Overtime Theater, a San Antonio company that focuses on new work, said, at the Overtime, we host the Flat Earth Awards every year. You send in a nomination for yourself or your theater, and you win. Every nomination gets an award. For the most part, though, the discussion was thoughtful. It was reflective. It was pushing for change. Many comments addressed the absurdity of ATAC judges trying to evaluate every production in town. And this is a problem. Any theater can enter any of its productions, and most theaters enter all of them. So there were complaints as well about the absence of a more streamlined system of nominations, as well as the opaque judging process. ATAC's lack of transparency made some readers wonder about how other communities judge their productions. One commenter, Allison Newsom, who later became a member of the ATAC board and then ATAC board president, shared some inside information. In speaking with an ATAC judge, however, I have learned of the way other communities do their award shows. One of them has a local newspaper critic determine the award recipients. Another one has a smaller panel, and then the judges have a meeting and vote on the shows who get the awards. I also think that the way the voting is done is flawed. You have to have X amount of judges see a show for it to even be qualified. And the problem there is that if you have too many judges see a show, that can actually hinder your chances at winning anything. Surprisingly, no one rejected being evaluated. In fact, they seemed to long for it and believe in its educative value. Even though the theaters do not receive a formal adjudication, nor are they allowed to see the ballots. What respondents seemed to want more than anything, though, was theatrical criticism. Who was judging and the actual receipt of credible feedback were what mattered. Roberto Prestigiacomo, our own Roberto, artistic director of Attic Rep, one of three theater companies in town that uses equity contracts, responded, we will benefit from an objective critique of the work that we present to our audiences and share with our fellow theater artists. It could help us grow and strive for a better theater, and isn't that what we all really want? Some respondents admitted, though, that they loved receiving Globe Awards, even though they agreed the system was unfair and thought it strange when less worthy shows won out over better ones. One busy local actor, for example, concluded that the Globe Award, it's kind of like a one-night stand. It's never as desired or interesting the morning after. This high-toned discussion expanded to a critique of the community itself. Chris Manley, who identified himself as the artistic director of a new theater company, The Rose, said, I do think all the theaters in town, especially the for-profit ones, should work together to help each other out. When we at The Rose first took over the theater in February, I extended the olive branch out to every theater and producer in town and received very little positive response. I think San Antonio theater is too competitive, the perfect example being the uproar over the Globe Awards. Over and over, in fact, respondents mentioned their distaste at the recriminations, jealousies, competition, and rumor mill that the system of judging inspired. This impromptu public forum led to immediate demands for meetings, discussions, and changes. The president of ATAC, Tom Macinter, was given a chance to defend ATAC in another piece in The Current, which also drew many responses and harsh rebuttals. Within a short time, Macinter had called a board meeting to discuss the article and its recommendations. Meanwhile, Thomas Jenkins and his editor at The Current were amazed. How had this remarkable event taken place? Another German, sorry. All right, philosopher Jürgen Habermas might explain the uproar as the birth of a specific public sphere. For its appearance meets what Habermas determines as three conditions for emergence: a disregard of status, a domain of common concern, and inclusivity. In a city as racially divided as San Antonio, and with theaters that run the gamut of funding, facilities, and resources, inclusivity and disregard of status is hard to achieve. But suddenly, through the medium of the internet, everyone was eligible, included, equal, and invited by The Current and its readers to contribute. Like the influential 18th century salons, Tischgesellschaften, or table societies, and coffee houses that Habermas describes in The Structural Transformation of the Public Sphere, the internet became a 21st century salon that put respondents on the same level, regardless of their cultural, educational, or financial status. This is a salon in which Voltaire's tragedy, The Orphan of China, is being read. As Habermas describes this phenomenon of social integration, in the salons of the fashionable ladies, noble as well as bourgeois, sons of princes and counts, associated with sons of watchkeepers and watchmakers and shopkeepers, in the salon, the mind was no longer in the service of a patron. Opinion became emancipated from the bonds of economic dependence. In the same way, The Current's comment section offered a free site of free exchange, removing the hierarchical structure usually observed in theatrical protocols of authority and communication. Artistic directors, the guys at the top, responded to lowly actors and ushers. Board members and judges answered to props masters and volunteers. The comments of the contributors made it clear that this kind of open forum about San Antonio theater was a new experience, and that for many, it was the first time that they had spoken to certain members of their own community, even though they had been working in the same field in the same city for many years. From their online discussion, readers arrived at what Habermas calls a domain of common concern, a realization of a shared identity and shared issues. One of the most common sentiments, in fact, was the need for community and solidarity in promoting the arts. Yet the most surprising effect was the phenomenon of the public's collective decision that an authoritative, long-standing entity in the theatrical community that until then had not been questioned should indeed be confronted and called to account. In true Habermasian spirit, the respondents used their public sphere as a regulatory institution against the authority of an accepted governing body in the arts. This public challenge led the Alamo Theater Arts Council to immediate self-examination and discussion, and based on my interview with the then ATAC president, changes in judge selection, judging procedures, and greater transparency about the judging process. The ATAC website now, for example, features a code of ethics for judges and award recipients, and detailed descriptions of how judges and award recipients are selected. Judges may no longer adjudicate a production if they serve on that company's board of directors, or if they have family members, colleagues, relatives, or students involved in the production. Artistic directors and theater administrators are no longer allowed to be judges, nor may ATAC board members serve in that capacity. By raising the numerical cutoff to 9 out of 10 possible points, ATAC has also trimmed the winners list considerably. Globe Awards now go to only 1 or 2 recipients in each category. These changes followed hard upon Tom Jenkins' original article in The Current, as confirmed by former ATAC board president Tom Center in a personal interview. So, The Current's gadfly, remember Tom Jenkins, was still not satisfied. In an article appearing almost a year to the day after his inflammatory ATAC screed, Thomas Jenkins noted and praised the ATAC's board improvements, particularly the new language on ethics and judging, but expressed exasperation at what he perceived as the board's provincialism and stubborn resistance to artists outside of San Antonio. This is the big issue now. He says, as revealed on the newly revised website, ATAC's reforms are a step in the right direction, though we at The Current are adopting a wait-and-see approach to the success of the implementation. At least a revised code of ethics will reduce some of the more flagrant conflicts of interests, and a stern warning to judges to ignore the content of a play might save some of the more edgy work from a Globe Award snub. There's still, however, one rule for Globe eligibility that sticks in our collective craw. Quote, actors, designers, and directors must be residents of San Antonio metro area to be considered. Jenkins went on to say, obviously, this rule does not go far enough in preserving the purity of San Antonio's theatrical vision. Certainly, the ban should require even more stringent politico-genetic affiliation, including Bexar County citizenship on both sides of the family tree through three generations. That is to say, a potential nominee for excellence should be no more than 1/16th non-Bexar citizen by DNA. In fact, some here at the current argue for disqualification based on a single drop of non-Bexar blood. Let us, however, be reasonable. It goes without saying that we need to discourage all non-Bexar actors, designers, and directors from ever setting foot in San Antonio, and disqualifying them for non-artistic considerations seems as good a way as any. This year, the rule not only boots Eric Moda, a local actor who moved to New York, from a chorus line, he is now, gasp, a New Yorker, but has the added bonus of disqualifying Trinity's guest director, Carl Weber. Professor Weber was a pupil and colleague of Bertolt Brecht, as well as a widely regarded translator and director in his own right. But honestly, what good ever came out of the Berliner Ensemble anyway? Best to keep that kind of stagecraft out of the Alamo City. Clearly, much work lies ahead, but the considerable changes wrought by the proliferation of quality theatrical criticism from a small staff of reviewers at The Current, and by what Habermas terms lay judgment in online publications and blogs, prove that there is reason for optimism. In The Death of the Critic, Ronan McDonald laments the rise of the blogosphere and online commenters, claiming that the increasing hordes of commentators make one opinion as valid as another, thus diminishing the role of the critic as an authoritative evaluator of art. In fact, McDonald thinks that the overwhelming abundance of opinions just dilutes and distracts. Yet, if the enthusiastic reader response to Jenkins's ATAC expose is any indication, then announcing the death of the critic might be premature. By the time Jenkins wrote his attack on the San Antonio theater establishment, he had already contributed dozens and dozens of columns, almost 5 years of rigorous theatrical criticism and active online dialogue with readers, discussing, analyzing, instructing, and arguing about what makes good theater. Had Jenkins written another gold star as a sporadic contributor to The Current, or even as a respected guest writer from another city, readers would have likely responded with outrage rather than the near universal support that his article received. It was Jenkins's extensive track record as a perceptive and consistent critical voice that generated the trust necessary for a usually insular and conservative arts community to follow his lead and demand change. That readers agreed with his criticism of their own community attests to Jenkins' status as, quote, a judge of quality and a guide to meaning. From Habermas. Granted, San Antonio is only one community, and in this digital era, actual books of theater criticism might be heading towards extinction, but the internet has restored the possibility of a wide readership, well beyond those patrons who might at one time have purchased a volume of criticism or borrowed one from a library. Moreover, the internet affords readers not just greater access, but the opportunity for critical engagement between critics and consumers. For Habermas, the public exercise of rational critical debate empowers citizens by enlarging the public sphere through inclusion, shaping public opinion through persuasion, and putting pressure on individuals and institutions. The vociferous readers of The Current moved the discourse from an emotional diatribe about ATAC to a reasoned discussion of the role of theater in general and the function of criticism in particular. Ultimately, they redirected their frustration from ATAC itself to a theatrical culture that made ATAC powerful, that had allowed competition for Globe Awards to supersede the greater satisfaction of art that has paid the compliment of public attention, public analysis, and public discussion, and maybe even a few extra patrons. Gotthold Lessing and Jürgen Habermas would be proud. What began as interrogation of an institution also led to some honest self-examination, suggesting a surprising level of maturity within an emerging theatrical community, and a promising indication that San Antonio might be ready for more emphasis on process rather than product. Yet this domain of common concern did not arise out of thin air. Jenkins's article on the ATAC Globes was a flashpoint, to be sure, but I posit that his Molotov cocktail thrown at the Alamo Theater Arts Council might well have fizzled without his leadership in the gradual construction of a theatrical public sphere. Similarly, through his articles, reviews, his blog, and responses to reader comments, Jenkins assumed the role of the dramaturg, of expert and educator, but also as a liaison between theaters and their audience, stimulating readers, challenging artists, inviting comment, and responding to online arguments. Thus, it was the increasing presence of legitimate theatrical criticism that led to such rational discourse, that led to company meetings, that led to higher professional standards, and to theater companies' greater openness to discussion of their work. For example, the then editor of The Current, Elaine Wolfe, told me in an interview in 2005 that when Jenkins, her lone theater critic, by the way, first began publishing reviews, some companies were astonished that a journalist had actually taken an interest in their work and wanted to discuss it, not just summarize it, in a public forum. Not everyone, of course, reacted well to Jenkins' interest, especially if it involved a bad or even a mixed review. The range of comments I heard and read at that time in the salons of theater lobbies and internet postings reflected the SA theater community's long-standing identity crisis. Some artists were taken aback at Jenkins' effrontery. How dare he intimate that San Antonio theater was not professional? On the other hand, some complained that Jenkins took their work too seriously, and he was just picking on hardworking amateurs who shouldn't be held to such high standards. It was really interesting. But note what happens when an activist critic arrives on the scene, especially one who is widely read, sees many productions a year in major cities, wields a mighty pen, and is armed with years of theatrical experience. A writer who actually knows a production's history, is familiar with the playwright's other works, and provides a critical context that illuminates the work and defines artistic standards. From his first review, Thomas Jenkins got San Antonio's attention. His trenchant critiques appeared, and suddenly Jenkins was the Lone Ranger. The buzz around theatrical circles was, who was that masked man? Everyone was dying to discover the identity of the upstart who called them on ham-fisted acting, second-rate stagecraft, shop-worn plays, and unimaginative staging. More maddening still, this know-it-all took their work seriously, yet wrote about it with wit and enthusiasm. He took theaters to task for provincialism and shallowness, but was not stingy with praise for innovation and depth. He was tough to please, but worth pleasing. And because Mr. Jenkins maintained a polite, professional distance, rather than ingratiating himself with this or that company, theater artists came to look at his criticism as not just discerning, but fair and reliable, so they listened and learned. In fact, they came to expect his coverage and comments and were sorely disappointed if, in the course of his busy reviewing schedule, they were not on his docket. In fact, editor Elaine Wolfe told me that some companies began calling ahead, asking to be reviewed. When certain productions were not covered due to time or personnel limitations, artistic directors were hurt and called to find out why they'd been overlooked. By this time, The Current had engaged two other critics to keep up with the demand. So Jenkins himself has received emails and phone calls from the directors and actors thanking him for his criticism, asking questions, sometimes disagreeing, but nearly always thanking him. Some have even asked him to serve as a consultant, a dramaturg, as an in-house critic, watching rehearsals and offering advice, but he declines, wanting to maintain his independence and impartiality. Clearly, theaters in San Antonio are starved for thoughtful responses to their work. That they seek this opportunity, knowing they risk negative comments, suggests that more rigorous criticism is influencing the climate of a city that until recently was unused to serious evaluation of its theatrical art. Consider the impact of Jenkins' single editorial on the Globe Awards. The salutary effect of one provocative, well-argued critique. Now imagine that impact times 10. That's what I'd like to get editors of San Antonio Monthly and Plaza de Armas and programming directors of San Antonio radio and television stations to imagine so that they will step up to provide our community with consistent, high-level theater criticism widely shared in various media outlets to expand the conversation about art and why it matters. More and better criticism has the power to take San Antonio to the next level. For example, Jenkins has also broadened the conversation to formerly taboo subjects. Recent review postings take readers on new paths through our domain of common concern, including big picture issues of season selection and a theater's vision. I'll close by offering you concrete examples of Mr. Jenkins' contributions to the public sphere. Within the space of 5 years, by opening a dialogue, challenging the status quo, offering a broader perspective, and insisting on excellence, he has provoked, browbeaten, and inspired the San Antonio theater arts community, largely by making them aware of what they could accomplish through complaints, discussion, and communicative action. In the salons of green rooms, theater lobbies, board meetings, online publications, and social media, they held their theater arts council accountable for inept, slack, and unethical standards. They demanded and got change in that organization's rules to address those faults. They accepted criticism with more grace and agitated for more coverage from local theater critics. They sought and obtained new leadership at 3 major theaters and agitated for seasons that appealed to a wider, younger, and more diverse demographic. More challenging plays, more contemporary dramas, more original work. For 3 years now, I've taught dramaturgy and dramatic criticism to spawn more feisty, knowledgeable, and principled critics like Thomas Jenkins. And at least 4 of my students have either been accepted or are applying to graduate dramaturgy programs or internships. They want to be like Tom. I'm hoping, too, that The Current will continue to hire more qualified arts journalists and collaborate with other media outlets in San Antonio to devise a system of annual awards with real prizes. At the very least, evaluation and distinctions from a critical mass of critical voices unaffiliated with local theaters that will deflect some of our community's animus from the blood sport of the Globe Awards. Better that theater folk vent their spleen at critics, right, than each other. At the most, a body of disinterested critics will reinforce standards of excellence, articulate goals to aspire to, applaud extraordinary efforts, and help a lame theater town like San Antonio leap ahead toward more good theater and less drama. Thank you.
Drudge, class of 1973.
Hi.
Hi. Are your students, is there any outlet for them to publish their criticism? Either is your department running a blog on the internet or in the Trinitonian or some way that they
can? No, and that's such a great question because we were actually talking in class on, yesterday, Tuesday, about beginning a blog of theatrical criticism because my students just finished this new unit that we did on criticism that was actually led by Thomas Jenkins. I asked him to come into class. We had read a number of his reviews and reviews from other critics in major cities. We talked about what makes a good review. We talked about Goethe's principles of, you know, what was done, how well was it done, and is it worth doing? And that's one of the things that Jenkins focused on most, is it worth doing, that we as critics have an obligation to communicate to readers high standards. You know, is this play relevant? Why should we care about this play? Is this theater putting on this play just because it has nice roles for the people who run it, or does it have something to say? So we're thinking about beginning a blog, and Jenkins actually encouraged a few of the students who were interested in submitting a kind of practice review, I suppose, a kind of review on spec, right, to the editor of The Current. He thought that the editor would be open to it. And I think it's a great idea because in some ways students are, because they're students, I think people will give them a little bit of leeway and tolerance, right, as long as the review is well-written and it's well-intentioned. Theaters in town might stand for review from a well-intentioned student than maybe someone who is from other sort of some other sort of organization. I mean, in some ways, San Antonio is a really large community, but we're kind of a small town in theater. And that if someone's too closely affiliated with this or that theater, they're immediately thought of to be biased. And I think coming from a university like Trinity, there's a lot of trust of Trinity, thank goodness. And I just think it would be a great way to get them started, and a good launch pad into a graduate program if they have a track record of accepted reviews. Any other questions? Yes?
This might be more of a comment than a question, but I've lived here for many years, and at the San Pedro Playhouse was one of the few. Now we have so many.
Yes.
It's so diluted that, do you think we have too many?
No, I don't.
But then why, a lot of them don't get that many big of an audience.
Well, that's the problem. I think that's a great argument. There are some theaters that have a sparse audience, and those theaters are working on that. They're trying. That's why I'm promoting the idea of criticism, to get the word out about the wonderful work that is being done in some of these smaller theaters. For example, one of our professors, Kyle Gillette, is the new artistic director of the Overtime Theater. And this is a theater that does nothing but new work, original pieces. Mainly written by people in this area, although they do get submissions from people around the country. It's so important for San Antonians to get out and see the type of theater that is new, that is being written by people in our community about issues they care about. So where I'd like to go is more critics, more media exposure to get more people into the theater. I just think that San Antonio's theater audience is small because many San Antonians don't have the culture of going to the theater, the habit of going to the theater.
Well, another thing, you said that this was a small venue, and San Antonio is the seventh largest state.
Yeah.
But most cities this size or smaller have large suburbs. And this city does not have a large suburb population that puts it well past into the millions.
Well, I don't know enough about demographics to argue with that, but one of the things that we've noticed is that most of our theaters are centrally located. They are within the center of the city, and it's very hard for us to get people from the northern suburbs, especially people who have the money to attend theater, to come into San Antonio and see plays. So that's going to be a real focus for us. I'm a dramaturg and one of the staff directors for Attic Rep. Some of you might know that Attic Rep began here at Trinity University as the resident professional company in the theater program here on campus. And it has allowed our students to work with professional actors, professional troupes that have come in to work on stage, backstage, as designers. It's been a wonderful opportunity, but thankfully, Attic Rep, its audience has grown, and we've been invited to be the resident theater troupe at the new Tobin Center for the Performing Arts. But, you know, the question is, will we be able to fill that space? It's a larger theater. It's not the giant theater that will have mainly the ballet and touring road shows and other things. It's a black box, but it's definitely bigger than our space here. So we're devising ways to create more media exposure, ways to get audiences to come in and make our first season a success. And we're a little bit daunted, but we're gonna try.
Robert Browning, and this tradition of drama at Trinity and in our city is very precious to my wife and I. We have spent the decades of our married life together going to many plays, including at Trinity, the wonderful Paul Baker plays, the plays, the Ibs, Howard Incarnate Word, and in general, over many of these decades, we found ourselves having a difficult time getting into, such was the craving for people to go to an entertaining evening of theater, that that it was oftentimes if you decided to go, you were lucky to barely fit in to a space available, you know, at the theater. So whether it's a change of the times or whatever, it's a shame to have the problems of diminishing time available to enjoy theater be beset with this kind of squabbling and this picture of criticism that we have. So it's been difficult for me to engage with what's going on, but I want to thank you, though, for this rather technical description of criticism of criticism, which is hard for some of us to engage with. But what we really need to have refreshed is a survey of all that really is available at all levels. You've got the high school, the college, and the professional level, and actually, you know, in no way could our fair city of San Antonio be lame, you know, in the dramatic culture. I want to thank Trinity just briefly for this wonderful series of the Food for Thought luncheons, and I would like to put in a plug for rejuvenating and increasing it. This has turned out to be the only one this year in 2014 that we've been able to attend, and I'm sorry to see that there's so few. I think this is an absolutely excellent way to engage those of us who are interested in following Trinity on a more intimate level, to engage with the culture and the excellence of Trinity, and I certainly hope that this can continue and be re-strengthened to have perhaps back up to 5 or 6 or 7 of these a year.
Hear, hear.
So I have young children who are going to enter public school, and I have a concern generationally, as I get the feeling that arts is diminishing in funding, right? So it kind of comes down to that. So I hear that. I hear this this advocacy to promote the arts, but what battle is being done to usher that back into a younger generation? It's already an uphill battle. It's just going to be an uphill battle.
Penelope can speak to that. Penelope can speak to it.
So I've got to go, and I'm really sorry, this is wonderful, Stacey, but I just want to put in a big plug as a board member for the Magic Theatre, and just to highlight the fact that as we consider the future of that unique institution downtown, we're really trying to build in plans for developing adolescent theatre as well. They do incredible camp programs, as you probably know, but we're aware that that is a sort of transitional gap that San Antonio has. So A, plug, B, become a member, C, send your children to camp, and D, come and support us in an upcoming big capital campaign to get a really new cutting-edge theatre space for young people that will include a space for adolescents. Okay, I've got to go. Oh yes, and Richard Rosen, sorry, big plug, is an amazing alumni, and thank you. I did do Latin at school. Where's Tom Jenkins when you need him? So Richard Rosen, who is a Trinity grad, was the kind of progenitor of that remarkable children's theatre. So end of my plug. I've got to go. It was fantastic, Stacey.
Thanks for helping. Thanks. Well, Logan, thank you for saying that, because your generation needs to take their children to the theater. You know, in some ways, I don't know if it's just the kind of moral opprobrium that has been attached to theater for such a long time. The best way to really upset my Quaker grandparents was to tell them that I wanted to be an actress. You know, they were just sure that I would go to New York and become a heroin addict, or that I would have 7 divorces or something like that. There's still a kind of puritanical distrust of theater. And so parents tend to allow their children to be involved in theater if they express this incredible passion and desire for it, right? Then they'll say, okay, yeah, you can go to the theater camp, or you can, okay, I'll, you know, take you to the ice capades or whatever. But theater is for everyone. Taking a child to a theater camp, and it's a wonderful thing to do in the summer because it's an all-day activity. They get to do so many different things. They get to develop confidence, they get to develop their imaginations. It's such a learning experience that when children decide, you know, what they end up wanting to do in life, they may want to be doctors or dentists or, you know, some other sort of thing totally unrelated to theater, but they will have the theater-going habit, that art will be an important part of their lives. When you expose children to theater early, they love it. They love it, and they continue to go. We have to compete with so many things these days, don't we? You know, the internet and Game Boys and my son's DS and people just looking at their phones all night. There are inherent difficulties in persuading people to go to the theater. I mean, there are surveys out there that you can read where people don't want to go to the theater because they don't want to go downtown, because they can't find a place to park, or they're actually afraid of being mugged, that people are afraid of that. And that's a lot to contend with. So we need to find ways to make this kind of entertainment something to, you know, come home, you know, eat some dinner or go out and have some dinner and go. It's so much easier, isn't it, on a Friday when you're exhausted to just flop down on the couch and watch something on Netflix. But it's so rewarding when you get out and go to the theater. I mean, admittedly, I'm such a dyed-in-the-wool theater person. I don't even mind bad theater because then I get to discuss it and talk about why it's bad, right? And my husband was a professional actor for many years, and he teaches theater, and we have this long-running discussion about, would you rather see a bad play or a bad movie? And he'd always rather see a bad movie, and I'd always rather see a bad play because I like the live experience. But getting people to take the risk to see something, you know, that they might not think is the greatest thing, but to enjoy the live experience is something that it just takes some doing in this day and age. So we're working on a marketing plan. We're working on ways to make theater affordable for everyone. We're working on ways of making a theater evening an event, a special event, and to not make people feel that they have to dress up for the theater. I mean, what is that? That's just a crazy idea. In fact, I actually forbid my students from dressing up at the theater. I say, wear your worst-looking jeans and a t-shirt. All they want is your money. You can sit wherever you want. Go be comfortable at the theater. Enjoy the theater. We just have this kind of elitist idea that theater is something where you put on your mink and your pearls and you have to behave and be quiet, and you don't, you really don't. I encourage people to go and talk to the actors on stage. Turn off your cell phone, but you can talk to the actors on stage, they'll love it. So theater is not a place where you should behave, and so we've got to get that idea out, that theater is a vital place where you're not just silent and having to, you know, sit there with your hands folded in your lap. You can participate. And most of the theater in San Antonio is very casual, very relaxed, and invites that kind of engagement. So we just need to get a new slogan, don't we? Keep San Antonio lame. Help me figure out something new. I mean, I'm afraid this is going to stick, and we don't want that. We want San Antonio to get beyond this idea of being a kind of so relaxed that you basically just sit around all the time, as opposed to really engaging in the arts, right? So that's my spiel.
Cool. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah.